secondly, a single shot version of the Enfield individual weapon produced at the Royal Ordnance Factory at Enfield Lock. It is part of the 5.56 Enfield Weapon System, or EWS, consisting of the individual weapon, equipped with or without an optical sight, depending on its deployment, and a light support weapon. Both may fire single shots or automatic. The cadet weapon differs to its regular army counterpart in that it has no flash illuminator, a 20-round as opposed to 30-round magazine, the cleaning kit is stowed on the weapon, the back sight is adjustable from 100 to 500 metres, and of course it can only fire single shot. Hence it has no fire selector and has the addition of a cocking handle extension to facilitate ease of recocking of the weapon whilst firing in the prone position. Now let's have a look at the weapon. Forward of the butt is the holding open device, enabling the working parts to be held to the rear for inspection. There is a dust cover preventing muck entering the body of the weapon. It opens automatically when the weapon is cocked. The 20-round magazine, which has its release catch on the left-hand side of the magazine housing. The pistol grip, containing pull-through and combination tool. The safety catch. This is a pull-push design similar to that fitted to the general purpose machine gun and is situated just above the trigger. The cocking handle with the special extension bar for the cadet weapon, which fits at the rear into the normal cocking handle. The top cover on the individual weapon, this covers the gas part. The absence of these on the cadet weapon means that the oil bottle is stored here instead. The sighting system consists of a simple aperture backsight mounted in the carrying handle, adjustable for windage by the use of a knurled drum situated on the right-hand side. And a foresight of the normal blade type with adjustment for elevation by use of a wheel contained in the foresight post. The weapon is simple and straightforward to operate and easy to strip and assemble. Normally, the weapon is held in the right hand, the left hand being used for most other tasks. First, we remove the magazine. Press on the magazine release cap and pull down the magazine. Then, we check that the weapon is clear. Pull the cocking handle back, look inside, and push the working part forward. But do not operate the trigger. Next, place the muzzle down against a clean, firm surface. Pull out the rear body locking pin to its first position. Pull out the forward body locking pin fully. Rotate the weapon and we can then remove the entire trigger mechanism assembly. Put it down. Place the hand over the rear of the weapon and withdraw the rear body locking pin fully. This will allow us to remove the recoil rod assembly. Disengage the cocking handle from the breech mechanism assembly by pulling back the cocking handle and then removing it from the breech. Slide out the cocking handle assembly. Remove the breech assembly. Place the body down. The weapon is now stripped into its six main component parts, and though further stripping can be carried out, this is probably all the cadet will be required to do. First of all then, we have the barrel and body assembly, the breech mechanism with its much favoured rotating bolt, the special cocking handle fitted to the cadet weapon, the recoil rod assembly. Note that the return spring remains attached to the centre rod. And though called the trigger mechanism, this does include the butt and the magazine housing. And finally, the magazine itself, which is interchangeable, incidentally, with that fitted to the American M16A2. Reassembly is simply the reverse of the stripping. Picking up the body of the weapon, we replace the breech mechanism, sliding it down sufficiently far to allow us then to replace the cocking handle. Slide it onto its runner and then push the cocking handle back into the recess in the breech mechanism. Push forward both the cocking handle and the breech mechanism fully. We now replace the recoil rod assembly. Slide it down into the correct holes in the rear of the breech mechanism. Push it down to the level with the rear of the body and put the face of the rear body locking pin to its first position. That will hold the recoil rod assembly in place. We now refit the trigger mechanism assembly. Close the rear body locking pin completely. Close the forward body locking pin completely. Pick up the weapon and check if it is working correctly. Cock the weapon. Look inside. Working part forward. Squeeze the trigger. Apply the safety gas. We now replace the magazine. The weapon is now fully reassembled and ready for action. Correct eye relief may be obtained by moving the carrying handle, which of course contains the backsight, backwards and forwards to suit the fire. Note how little the weapon moves when a shot is released. When the magazine is empty, the holding open device keeps the breech mechanism to the rear, and this allows the fire to change the magazine and carry on firing without having to recock.
No, the bottom of the two weapons pictured is not the cadet rifle. It is in fact the all-armed version of the Army's individual weapon system designed to replace both the SLR and the SMG in general service. Above it, the infantry special forces version, fitted with the 4x magnification optical sight in place of the conventional iron sights. Note the flash eliminator, which allows for the firing of a muzzle-launched grenade and the fitting of the all-purpose bayonet. The flash eliminator, together with a 30 as opposed to 20 round magazine and the absence of the cadet rifle's special cocking mechanism, are the only easily detectable differences between the cadet and general service versions of this weapon. There is in fact an 85% commonality of parts between them. The top weapon also has a sling fitted. This is issued with all versions, including that issued to cadets. So, the cadet forces are now to be equipped with a modern, effective, but simple weapon system. And from the cadet's point of view at least, this must be a step in the right direction.